So hello to all of you. So today I'm with the new experiment. Then the name of the experiment is TDM, that is time division multiplexing and the demultiplexing. So basically the TDM is used in digital communication network. It is used basically to transmit multiple signals simultaneously through the same channel. Okay, we use the same channel to transmit multiple signals. Okay, so these signals are independent. Okay, these could be sine wave, cos, triangular wave. We can send digital signals also here. Okay, so these kind of signal can be sent here. Okay, and we send it through a common signal path by mean of synchronized switches. Okay, so each signal is allotted a fixed time slot and a sample of that corresponding signal is transmitted during that period. After one sample, each of the signal is sent, the time slot is given back to the first signal, and again this process repeats and repeats on for all those signals which are going to pass through the same path. Okay, so here I have written the data. Okay, that how the actually the circuit works. The circuit is for multiplexing part and the circuit is for demultiplexing part. Okay, so I will explain you the theory by the help of this diagram only. Okay, so basically what happens in this TDM here, this one is the switching signal. Okay, basically the clock signal here, this one is signal 2 and this one is signal 1. So I have chosen here a digital signal here and here a sine wave signal. Okay, so basically what happens for the positive clock of this switching signal, what happens? There are two transistors which act, okay, at a positive interval. One of the transistor turns on and the other one turns off. Okay, and this 741 IC, it is used basically here as an adder. Okay, so I will tell you that how actually this works. So here you can see this one is NPN transistor, this first one, and the second one is PNP transistor. Okay, and here the emitter of both of the transistor is grounded. Understood. And here we are using this 741 IC as an adder, but here we are giving the signal to 74 IC at pin number 2, that is the inverting terminal of this 741 IC. Okay, so now how actually this signal works. Suppose the switching signal, currently it is the positive part at the positive interval. Okay, we are considering the positive interval of this switching signal. So what happens at this positive interval of this switching signal? This first transistor, that is NPN, it is turned on and this PNP transistor gets turned off. Okay, so when this NPN transistor gets turns on, this signal, that is signal 2, it goes from this NPN transistor to ground. Okay, so we are not getting any signal to the IC 741 from the signal 2 path. Okay, when we are having this switching signal to be at positive interval, so this signal vanishes, and at that time only this signal, okay, it will go to pin number 2 of this 741 IC. Okay, similarly when this switching signal comes in negative part or for the negative interval of this switching signal, this PNP transistor, it turns on and this NPN transistor turns off. So when this PNP transistor turns on, this signal, signal 1, it goes to the ground. Okay, that means it vanishes, and this signal 2, okay, this will go to the pin number 2. So in one oscillation of this switching signal, for the positive one, we are getting signal 1 here, and for the negative interval, we are getting signal 2 here. Okay, at the input of 741 IC, and both the signals are seen simultaneously at the TDM output. Okay, for one switching oscillation of this signal. Okay, or for one oscillation of this switching signal. Okay, this is how this circuit works. Okay, now here this one is the demultiplexing circuit. Here also we are going to use one NPN and one PNP transistor. And since in the TDM, what happens, we are going to synchronize this thing. So we are going to give the same switch input or the same switching signal which we have provided to the multiplexer circuit. Okay, in the demultiplexer circuit also the switching signal would be same. Okay, so we are going to provide TDM input here, okay, to both the collector part here. Okay, so here also the emitter of both the transistors are grounded. So we are going to provide here the input to the collector, as we have provided the input of the signal here also to the collector's part. So here also what happens when the switching signal is at positive interval. Okay, for the positive interval of the switching signal, what happens? This transistor, this upper ones, okay, it turns on and this one turns off. So when this turns on, okay, the signal which is going from this part, okay, it gets grounded, and the signal which we are getting from this collector part, okay, it goes through, okay, and it arises here at the output part. Okay, similarly for the negative of this switching input, what happens? This PNP transistor, it activates, okay, and this NPN transistor, it turns off. So since this PNP transistor activates or it switches on, so the signal which is going from this side, from the lower side, okay, it goes to the ground, and the signal which is coming from this part, okay, it goes to the output part. Okay, now you can see here at the output here, after this junction, we are connecting one resistor and one capacitor here. So you can look this at a low pass filter, as a low pass filter also, okay, or an envelope detector. Okay, so basically we are using an envelope detector here. The reason is that the signals which we are getting here, okay, it looks like samples of pulse. Okay, it looks like samples of pulse. Okay, so basically to detect that part and to finalize it as a continuous analog signal, we need a detector. Okay, so we are going to use an envelope detector in both the part here. Okay, so this is how this multiplexing circuit and this demultiplexing circuit works. Okay, I have written those theory here also. Okay, but I have explained it to you. Now moving on to the multisim part. Just look here, I have drawn here the circuit. Okay, it is having all the components, the values you can see here. I am going to provide here the clock signal here. Okay, here I have provided a sine wave, 2 volt peak to peak, 100 hertz. And here, the signal 1, I have provided it here, the triangular wave. Okay, it is also 100 hertz. Amplitude is 2 volt peak to peak. Here, this one is the NPN transistor 2N, 4 times 2A. And here, this is the PNP transistor 2N3702. Okay. So emitter is grounded here in both the part, okay, and here we are going to provide the input signal to the collector. You can see here at the pin number 2, I have provided here the input of for the 741 IC, and I have provided here minus 12 volt and plus 12 volt here to this IC. So when we are going to get the output here of the TDM, okay, if you want to see that how actually it looks like, I will show you. I will add an oscilloscope here. Okay, and I will also add a ground here. So just look here that how actually this looks like. I will reverse it here. Okay, it looks nice. Okay, so stop it here. So since we have used a triangular wave and a sine wave here, you could see in the time sharing part that how does it looks. Okay, this one is the triangular signal, and here you can look, this one is the sine wave also. Okay, the sine wave is running also in the same part You can see here that the triangular wave is also running, okay, in the time-shared manner. Okay, so this is how the stadium waves actually runs. Okay, so this one is the output of the TDM, and you can see here the output of the TDM. Here I have connected it to the demultiplexing circuit here. Okay, the circuit which I have shown it to here. Okay, so we have provided it both to the collector part of both the transistor. So from here, it has been provided to the collector of this NPN transistor, and I have provided it also to the collector of this PNP transistor. Okay, and at the base of both the transistor, I have provided the clock signal here. Similarly, I have provided here clock signal also. You can see 2 kilohertz, 2 volt peak to peak, and 2 kilohertz, 2 volt peak to peak. This signal. Okay. So here afterwards, I have provided the detector here. Okay. So that we could get a nice kind of wave here. Okay. So I will run it again and I will show you that how actually it looks. So here you can look at the wave here. So the first one or this signal, okay, this would be my signal 2. So my signal 2 would be my sine wave, and this signal 1, okay, that is was the base one. Okay, this one was my triangular wave. So at this part, from the bottom part, that is of red color, okay, the wire is of red color since. So the red color output is the triangular wave, and the violet color output, it is of sine wave. Okay, so you can look here it nicely. Okay, I'm just changing here the divisions. Just look here, both these waves are present here. Okay, so if you want to see the frequency of the signal, that whether we have got the original wave or not, you can see here the frequency of the sine wave is also 100 hertz, and the frequency of this signal, triangular wave, is also 100 hertz. Okay, so we'll look at the frequency of both the wave here. Suppose I'm just going to delete one of my connection, that is the red one. Okay, and now we'll see only the frequency of this violet one signal. Okay, so it runs from this part. Suppose I'm going to take here the head part, or just take the starting part or the zero portion. From here, okay, it runs from here to here. Okay, so the wave you can see here, it is the one oscillation of this sine wave. Okay, so the time difference between 1 and 2 is minus 10 milliseconds. So this is minus 10 milliseconds, as this one is T2 minus T1. Okay, so T2 is less here and T1 is greater, that's why we are getting a negative sign here. If we will exchange the position of 1 and 2, and we will get 10 milliseconds. Okay, so that's not any issue. Okay, so basically we are getting 10 milliseconds of the time difference. So when we are getting 10 milliseconds of the time difference, if you will convert it into the frequency, you have to inverse it. Okay, so 1 by 10 milliseconds. Okay, so if you will do that thing, you will get surely 100 hertz of the signal. Okay, so yeah, we are getting very nicely the first signal here, our, okay, that is our, sorry, second signal, that is our sine wave. Okay, now I will just analyze here simply the first signal, that is the signal looks connected here. Okay, so now I will run the simulation again and just look at the output here. So we are getting here the wave nicely. So we are going to check here that what is the time difference of the cursors here. Okay, so take 1.2 be here a little bit and 1.2 be here approximately. Okay, okay, it looks good. Okay, so you can here that the time difference between T2 and T1 is 10 milliseconds. So we are getting positive 10 milliseconds, as the T2 here is greater, okay, and T1 is here is lesser. Okay, in the previous one we have done T2 minus T1, but we have got minus 10 milliseconds because the second cursor was at this point and the first cursor was at farther point. Okay, so the 10 millisecond, if you inverse it, you will surely get the 100 hertz of the signal. Okay, so from this thing, I think you have understood that how to perform the TDM and the multiplexing, and sorry, it's demultiplexing part. Okay, so here we have seen that there are many ripples in the this second wave, first wave also, and in the second wave also. Okay, the ripples are because we haven't chosen a very good value of the resistor and capacitor so that we could detect very nicely the wave, okay, the signal first and the signal second. Okay, so if we will change the value of these capacitor and resistor here, okay, little bit, not much, okay, so we will get approximately no ripple, okay, and we will get a good quality of wave there. Okay, so I hope you understood that how to do the TDM and its demultiplexing part, the time division multiplexing and demultiplexing part. So this one was the end of the experiment. So thank you.